Namaskar, and a very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Aishwarya, and it's indeed my honor to welcome to CILT India Expo 2019 our esteemed guests, distinguished speakers, and respected delegates and visitors. We'll now begin with our plenary session for the day, Development of Logistics Infrastructure. This session has been partnered by NDR Infrastructure Private Limited. It's my honor to welcome on the dais our honorable chair, Shri Anil Gupta, logistics advisor, UNESCAP and former CMD CONCOR. Our keynote speaker, Mr. Tushar, Kanade, public policy advisor, India, Virgin Hyperloop One. And panelists, Shri Kalyan Swaminathan, director, service business, Balmer, Lawrie and Company Limited, Shri Shashi Bhushan Shukla, member, Traffic, Inland Waterways Authority of India. Shri S.P. Mishra, Director, Directorate General of Lighthouses and Lightships. Shri Tamal Roy, Business Development President and Corporate Strategy, Jame Baxi Group. Shri Ramesh Agarwal, CMD, Agarwal Packers and Movers Limited. And Shri Naidu Adi Kesavulu Reddy, Chairman, NDR Infrastructure Private Limited. Our chair, Shri Anil Gupta, is the logistics advisor, UNESCAP and former CMD CONCOR. He headed the Container Corporation of India for almost 7 years until 2016. He was the first chairman come managing director of the company, which is a conglomerate of 16 companies operating in the logistics sector of India. Shri Gupta's specialties, expertise and skills in the areas of marketing and commercial activities, ports and shipping, railway operations, and intermodal and landslide transport logistics and distribution helped CONCOR reach great heights, making it an undisputable market leader with over 75% market share. Shri Gupta has been associated with a large number of professional research work for World Bank, IBRD, and UNESCAP, and has served as the task force member for formulation of some of our erstwhile five-year plans. Post-retirement, Shri Gupta is actively associated with many projects, including a project for UNESCAP and four companies, including AAI Cargo's subsidiary company as an independent director. Welcome, sir. I now invite you to kindly inaugurate the session.
Good morning. Welcome to everybody to this particular session organized by CILT, who've been very, very thoughtful in organizing this special session on infra, logistics infra, which everybody must be wondering, must be taking to be the main villain of India's progress, especially when one hears like we have logistics costs of 13 to 14%, which are supposed to be 8 to 9%, and we know that what does that mean? That means our input output costs are higher and we are living in a high cost economy. It was in fitness of thing that the CILT thought of this as a main subject, because a lot of things are happening in infrastructure. Ports, we all know, are having ambitious plans. They are growing. To share with house, today port capacity for handling containers, I will talk about containers. It's unfair. I should be talking about all logistics, but my training is especially for containers. For container handling, port capacity today is 28.5 million TEUs. I think everybody here understands the word TEU, so I need not explain. It's 20-foot equivalent unit in which container is measured. Port capacity is 28.5 million, and India has handled 17 million TEUs last year. So actually, we have handled only 59% of the port capacity. We have 41% extra capacity. And then somebody says that we have an infra problem because of which our costs are higher. It's very unfair. Is that enough? Or are there things behind this 28.5 million TEU capacity? Is this capacity available in the right mix in which it is required? For instance, Eastern Coast ports are today handling 79% of the traffic. 21% traffic is being handled in the East Coast ports. Do we have a mismatch of capacity requirement and its utilization in different ports? So Those are the kind of issues that we'll be talking about in port infrastructure, railway infrastructure. Our railway share is today 31% in billion ton kilometer. Now, everybody knows we are a country of large distances, yet our rail share is only 31%. Is it the rail capacity constraint, or is it some other constraint? If rail capacity constraint is there, with the ongoing projects of DFCCIL, of two freight corridors plus three more freight corridors which are likely to come, is that going to resolve the issue? Is that going to create capacity in the right places, in the right estimation in which it is required? Are we happy with DFCCIL providing the main capacity for some loops? What about the feeder routes? All these issues become very important while talking about the capacity. Third area, terminals. You have a port terminal having capacity of 28.5 million. You are presuming that around 60% of this traffic should move by rail. It should be. Will this 60% traffic have adequate rail capacity to move by rail and to get handled at the other end? Do we have terminals? Third issue. There are, I'm sure, a lot of friends here, they will say we have excess capacity, at least in NCR, for handling containers. We have excess capacity. Now, is there going to be a mismatch? How are we going to address the mismatch? Road infrastructure, which is handling 60%, are we doing very well in road? Are there no problems? Is this Bharat Mala program going to be a panacea of all ills? How are we really, what are the additional demands besides Bharat Mala, which even after fulfillment of Bharat Mala will be required? Warehousing capacity, whether that is enough, warehousing capacity, is the capacity of warehousing available of the right kind? We need bonded warehousing, we need transit warehousing, we need long-term warehousing, we need specialized warehousing. Are we really moving in the right directions in creating all these kind of capacities? We've been often accused that we have a large coastline, but we are not using water transport. Share is only 9%. That is also slightly better than before because of coastal shipping and other developments. Sagarmala is a very ambitious project. Are we really moving in the right direction in Sagarmala? In some sectors, for instance, yes. Northeast sector, for instance, Jogi Ghopa MMLP is being made to tune with the waterway terminals also. Are we having similar development plans in other fields? These are all the kind of questions. Land ports to do trade with neighboring countries like Bhutan, Bangladesh, Nepal and Pakistan. Are we having enough capacities at the land ports? The so-called ICPs that we've been talking about, developing 20 ICPs in two phases, are they going to make any difference? Has ICP Petropole made a difference after being a wonderful ICP to look? Have the detentions gone down? All these are issues which I think the actual practitioners can only answer. To that, we have a panel here comprising of Mr. Swaminathan from Balmer. Balmer is an organization which is running many CFSs in crucial locations. We have Mr. Shashi Bhushan Shukla from Inland Waterway Authority of India, who can throw some light on the Sagarmala program and how coastal shipping is going to take shape in future. Mr. Mishra from Lighthouse and Lightship Department of Government of India, Directorate of Government of India. Mr. Tamal Roy from JM Baxi Group, who are operating many port terminals, including Kandla Port. Mr. Ramesh Agarwal, Chairman of Agarwal Packers and Movers, who is in a big way in the transportation of smalls from place to place, facing road problems day to day. Mr. Keshav Reddy, Chairman of India Group, very big name in the warehousing, and Mr. Vivek Srivastav, Director of Operation of DFCCIL. What I plan to do is two of the panelists have presentations to make. I'll request them to first make their presentations. After that, I think we can have discussions on each aspect, on various issues that I have listed to be the important issues. And thereafter, we can throw the floor to audience for question answer. Thank you. Sorry, it's my omission. I've not mentioned name of Mr. Kanade, who is the keynote speaker about the absolutely new concept of vision Hyperloop, which we have been hearing about, but I don't think anybody is clear on what this vision Hyperloop, what kind of opportunity it presents for India, for passengers. And for the much awaited freight segment, if it is there at all. I think before coming to Mr. Mishra, I'll request Mr. Tushar Kanade to make his presentation, his keynote address, after which we can move to the presentations. Sorry, Mr. Kanade.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Gupta. So as the keynote speaker, of course, my job is to introduce the panel in terms of the discussions, of course. But what I would do is introduce the future of what we think is going to happen in the world of transport, in the world of freight transport, as well as, of course, passenger transport as well. So I'm Tushar Kanade. I'm a public policy advisor for India, for Virgin Hyperloop One. And I've been working with working on the Mumbai-Pune Hyperloop project, which is the foremost project of its kind, utilizing Hyperloop as the concept over the last 2.5 years. I was previously with the government of Maharashtra, with the Chief Minister's Office. Today, of course, we are still waiting, you know, on the cusp of going to tender at the government of Maharashtra to develop the world's first Hyperloop project. So here's how I'll structure the presentation. I'll give you an introduction of Hyperloop, as Mr. Gupta said, that a lot of people have heard about the technology or the company, but not too many people have clarity. I'll introduce the technology. I'll, you know, in the second half of the presentation, talk about how it's relevant to logistics, how our principal investor, one of our most prominent investors, DP World, of course, who also had a keynote presentation yesterday. We've developed a solution for logistics in collaboration with DP World and how that's aimed at transforming the future of freight transportation. Okay, so the rise of India's economic regions. Now, I'll quickly go through this, of course. Over the last 3 to 4 years, we've looked at different corridors, different, you know, demand cases for, you know, moving passengers or freight from A to B. And India, of course, has stood out in terms of the fact that it has some of the densest urban agglomerations in the world. Of course, there are other candidates for those agglomerations, such as the eastern seaboard of the US, or certain parts of Europe, certain parts of China. But the way we see India developing over the next 20, 30 years, you know, validates the fact that this is going to remain central to any new key technology that is going to execute its, you know, newer forms of transit over a sub 1,000 kilometer radius. And that's basically where, you know, Hyperloop technology actually plays its key role. Because with a theoretical top speed of around 1,200 kilometers per hour, and you know, most projects exhibiting speeds of 500, 600 kilometers per hour, that distance, that radius is crucial to executing this technology. And that's why India is so central to this dialogue. Just a snapshot of why India also, right? I mean, if you can look at the slide, transport demand has also exponentially increased, which is obvious for the fact that, you know, population itself has gone up a lot over the last 3 decades. Transport demand has grown about 8x over the last few years, over the last 30, 40 years. And obviously, to capture that kind of demand, we need to, you know, we need to utilize newer forms of technologies to, you know, bridge that gap rather than just use existing forms of technologies, existing forms of transportation, and expand on those efforts. Yeah, it's okay, I'll just do it. Okay, now that is the background. Obviously, it's a bit of a, you know, not a bit of a surprise for most of the people who are following transportation in India, but about last year, in February 2018, we had our, it's not changing. We had our global chairman, Richard Branson, come down to the investment summit in Maharashtra. We had him announce this project. He announced this project in the presence of the Honorable Prime Minister of India, of course, the Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra. I think the technology works. In this presentation, I can show you how this technology works.
Imagine traveling nonstop at up to 670 miles per hour, above land or underground. This is Hyperloop, a new mode of transportation that has been developed by Hyperloop One. It starts with an electric motor, which is broken up into two basic components, the rotor, which rotates, and the stator, which is stationary. The stator is an electromagnet, so when an electric current passes through it, the rotor is magnetically attracted to spin. Unlike a normal electric motor, the Hyperloop One motor isn't circular, it's linear. And the rotor is on the pod, which is propelled magnetically as it moves over the stator. Hyperloop One's unique technology uses magnetic levitation to guide and lift the pod off the track. Nearly all of the air inside the Hyperloop tube is removed using a series of vacuum pumps. This effectively creates our own sky inside the tube, as if you are quietly flying at 200,000 feet above sea level. This reduces drag, so only the smallest amount of electricity is needed to achieve extraordinary speeds, and creates a more cost and energy efficient system than high-speed rail or airline transport. Hyperloop One will be automated by the most advanced systems in the world, allowing a safe and efficient journey that's never delayed or overbooked. Hyperloop is the first new form of public transportation in over 100 years. Fundamentally, it will change the way we travel, work, and live. Welcome to the future. Welcome to Hyperloop One.
Okay, so the technology did work, and so will ours eventually. But just quickly going through the next few slides before coming to the logistics part of the technology. But this is the rough overview of how the pod or the technology itself is. There's a low pressure tube, roughly around a 70% vacuum. The pod itself is smaller than a typical metro bogey. They can be electrically coupled, so you can make carriageways or you can make convoys of multiple pods, depending on the kind of demand. But otherwise, they are solo, they go on their own, and of course, they're autonomously controlled. Yeah. I think these are some of the benefits. I'll just quickly skip through these. Feel free to reach out offline. Of course, these are questions, and there's a very simple answer. Of course, we're going to work with governments worldwide, as we're working with the government of India, as we're working with the government of Maharashtra, and different state governments in India, as well as in the US, to develop a regulatory framework so that the governments themselves, as is the usual process, develops a safety regulatory mechanism or a framework to look at how this technology can be implemented. Back at a test facility in Nevada, north of Las Vegas, we've already run hundreds of test simulations as well as actual tests with an actual pod. And we also had the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Mr. Fadnavis, visit us way back in June 2018 with his delegation of senior bureaucrats as well as other cabinet ministers in the Maharashtra government. And we've created the India pod, keeping in mind the kind of demand case that exists for Mumbai-Pune as a first phase of something much broader in terms of a network, Mumbai-Bengaluru being one, Mumbai-Delhi being the other, several other corridors under discussion, but primarily it's Mumbai-Pune, which is what we are trying to execute, what we are focused on executing over the next few years. This is a rough timeline. I'll quickly skip through this, but as of today, in August 2019, the government of Maharashtra, the cabinet of Maharashtra has declared this project as an infrastructure project, which is the first milestone because over the last 70, 80 years, this is the first new mode of technology that is now classified as per prevailing laws as an infrastructure project. So that's a big milestone that our company and this technology has witnessed over the last few months. Phase one, of course, is a 10 to 15 kilometer track in Pune. The entire phase two covers Mumbai-Pune, and that's the rough timeline for your reference. This is the route. We're estimating about 150 million passenger journeys annually. The good news is that we already have a demand case in the form of the Mumbai-Pune Expressway, which, as I was telling another panelist, is already on track to be doubled in terms of its capacity. By the state government, by the Maharashtra State Road Development Corporation. We have had our own surveys. We've done our groundwork in terms of the estimated demand, the induced demand because of such a short journey over such a vast distance, the new kinds of demand that would arise because of this technology as well. Of course, $55 billion in economic benefits over the next three decades. Now, this is what we call the new economy, right? It's not going to generate just the kind of jobs that we can predict today, but also newer kinds of jobs. Imagine if you were to live in a city such as Navi Mumbai, which is at the midpoint on this technology between Mumbai and Pune, and probably work in either of the cities. You can actually live in Pune, you can work in Mumbai. There are all sorts of combinations possible depending on where we connect this technology to. Of course, Make in India being a focus for us. These are some corridors before I jump into logistics finally. Delhi-Mumbai being 55 minutes. These are conservative estimates. These are not radical estimates. Because if you do the math, you do the arithmetic, you can just, you know, visit our website, look at the average speeds we're talking about. It's not as radical as the times themselves may say. Now, this is where we come to DP World cargo speed. DP World, of course, as I said, is one of our prominent investors. And, you know, as Tamal was also talking to me about this before this speech, why not test it on cargo first? Why not, you know, exclusively also look at freight? Why not separately also look at freight while also doing the passenger case? Now, all of those questions have popped up. We have explored those, and with DP World's investment in our firm and the interest that's generated in the broader freight sector, this is what we've built for them. Now, of course, these are some macro statistics. It's about a $4 trillion figure for e-commerce just next year. And that's global, of course, right? It's a 4x increase by 2050 in global freight, and of course, $500 trillion of express freight. Express freight is important because what does time-sensitive cargo have in terms of value? The fact that it needs to be delivered very fast, the fact that it will not be of value if it's delivered late. Currently, we just have air cargo. We have obviously different other modes, first, last mile modes of freight, which, of course, the esteemed panel will also discuss in much more technicality later on in the session. But that's what we're aiming for. What we want to do, and this is why existing players find it challenging, as it may very well be, right? How do you change a system that's, as Mr. Gupta mentioned, is focused on containers, it's focused on the idea of a TEU? How do you change that system? You introduce a new technology in a company? Not really. You introduce a new technology through a new platform, through a new ecosystem. That's what we're trying to do here, and that's what cargo speed is all about. We want to make cargo palletized. Of course, not all forms of cargo can be palletized, and obviously this will, you know, necessitate infrastructure investments in certain ports, in certain logistics parks, and so on and so forth. But whatever can be palletized, and that's a significant percentage, depending on which region or which country you talk about, will be palletized in the future through our system itself. That's pretty much the same port. It's pretty much the same benefits. Obviously, it serves a completely different purpose in this case. Yeah. Now, obviously, what the value proposition here for the larger logistics industry is that we have the speed of flight, because our average speeds would be around 400, 500 kilometers per hour, depending on the terrain. That's basically what we are going to do or deliver in terms of value to the sector. And that's why it's the speed of flight, but close to the cost of trucking. Now, this is exactly where a lot of you would want details, and this is exactly where we would want partnerships to collaborate on, to delve into the economics of it. Because from a private sector perspective, since the first few projects are going to be privately funded, especially the first phase of the Mumbai-Pune route is completely privately financed, it has to make economic sense. It has to be driven by market forces rather than any subsidy or any other assistance from any other entity. Which is why, for instance, our costing mechanisms, our economics, our cost economics capture this, capture the fact that only certain routes can take the kind of volumes or the kind of cargo at certain time sensitivities. And it's also the same infrastructure. So the tubes that will be built, for example, in the Mumbai-Pune case, can take passengers for, let's say, around indicatively 12 hours, 14 hours a day. But from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., for example, there'll not be a lot of passengers any which way, which is where we aim indicatively to use the same tubes for cargo, for the pods carrying time-sensitive cargo or other forms of cargo, which obviously go into the economic model. What does this mean for, the existing world of logistics? Of course, we will want to integrate ourselves in the modes of transport, the modes of logistics that exist today. The infrastructure that exists for logistics today can't be ignored, which is why integration is our theme, which is why integration in the form of new draft logistics policy that is being passed by the government of India is key in our investment efforts for countries like India. It's also 100% electric, so obviously it's There's no compromise in terms of the technology itself from an emissions point of view or any other. Now, this is exactly what would happen to supply chains in just a simple image, nothing radical, but the impacts are radical, right? You can have port capacity or airport capacity expanded just because you have on-demand access distribution centers. What does that mean? Just like you book an Uber today or an Ola today, where the car comes to you, similar to the concept that we are trying to put forth here, that by the time you reach as a passenger or by the time your cargo reaches the particular Hyperloop portal, which is basically nothing but the station, is exactly the time when the pods would be ready for you through a digitally controlled system, because the pods themselves are autonomously controlled. There is no driver as such, because the entire system is fully electric. So the idea for this may be radical, but the technology already exists. Apps already exist. Autonomous controls already exist, because it's not as complicated as a driverless car on a road that is also inhabited by human drivers. This can create on-demand access distribution centers in places other than currently where distribution centers exist, which effectively means you're expanding port capacity already, and not delving into expensive conversations of port capacity expansion at the area where they are. Other such, mega manufacturing parks or economic zones that are already being planned by governments all over India and all over the world. Lastly, it basically impacts all parts of the supply chain. It's not just about, or different aspects of the supply chain as well. It's not just about one end. It impacts manufacturing. It gives, local manufacturers, whether or not induced by Make in India or maybe existing manufacturers, a just-in-time manufacturing model. Because when you know your cargo can actually reach exactly when you want it to in a very short period of time, you don't really have to stock up inventory of different kinds altogether. The technical aspects of it, of course, is not under the purview right now in this keynote speech, but I obviously hope that the esteemed panel understands the nuances of what I'm really referring to right here. Distribution itself, a lot of it is revolutionized because of the on-demand nature of this transport. And we estimate, depending on the region you look at, we've averaged out the different regions we're evaluating worldwide, it's up to $10 billion in annual supply chain manufacturing ecosystem impact, depending on the region you look at, of course. That's pretty much it. Hope this introduced the technology in much more detail than you have been introduced to in the past. Happy to connect offline. And of course, as we start the panel discussion, I really hope these ideas have invigorated some excitement or some newer perspectives on what logistics looks like and what it can look like in the future. Thanks a lot.
Anybody would like to address any question to him? We will take it later.
I think that really depends on the route. So there's not a standard one. I can't answer that specifically because we're going to just go to tender. But it really depends on the route. So from a Mumbai-Pune point of view, it's similar to bullet trains, actually. It's slightly more affordable. Obviously, a longer route would mean more economies of scale. It would be much cheaper than high-speed rail in theory for something like a Bombay to Bangalore. But for Pune, yes, that is the order. And that's not much more, or it's pretty much the ballpark between a metro and a bullet train. Can go to as low as a metro as well.
Thank you. There is a suggestion that we'll keep all questions for the end. I now request Mr. Mishra to make a presentation. Mr. Mishra is the director in the DG Lighthouse and Lightships, and he's got a small presentation about his goal.
Good morning to all delegates and audience. Before starting, I would add little information regarding how that DGLL comes into picture, because as a matter of fact, if we go into history, we know Vasco da Gama landed in India on 20 May 1498. At that time, aids to marine navigation were of course negligent in the world, but he successfully landed. I'll quote another example. first Governor General, of course, who was a company storekeeper, and later on he became Governor General and who established British rule in India, Robert Clive. He was one of the 13 siblings of his parent, and out of which almost 50% only survived after childhood. Another quote, most of us may have read novel of William Shakespeare, that is Merchant of Venice, in which Antonio, the merchant, who meets misfortune only because his vessel is lost, and he goes for the loan and whatnot. So, out of these three instances, what I am talking to share is amount of uncertainty involved in the transportation and amount of uncertainty involved in the living. In case of another example, that is Robert Clive. Today, we have all, even our grandparents used to be one of multiple siblings. Today, we most of people have 1+1 or single one, single child, because certainty has improved. During those days, even vessels were not, your cargo was not insured, because people were not ready to insure it, especially insurers, because there were 100% uncertainty involved in the vessel movement. Today, multiple insurers are available in the world for your cargo as well as for your vessel. Why? Because of certainty now. Once vessel has started, it will reach. There is a definiteness. You know, you can track your vessel anywhere in the world because of today's technology. And how? That's how DGLL comes into play. DGLL has been agency who's providing aids to marine navigation in Indian waters. And before going into detail, I'll give you a little video on it. It will more clarify what DGLL has been doing in India for safe. Now, earlier the motto was only safe navigation. Today, safe and efficient navigation. So that there is a certainty in the productivity. Means you have sent some certain cargo, it should reach to its destination so that without any losses and in efficient time, in a faster way. So in that process, DGLL has established multiple aids to marine navigation, multiple technology using international practices and technologies like visual navigation. Almost 194 lighthouses have been established throughout India, including Lakshadweep and Andamans, Nicobar Islands, and around 23 differential global positioning systems, and one of the largest VTS. We have got also navigation warning system, that is Navtex. We have established around 7 stations, 87 shore-based automatic identification shore-based stations, which help identify your vessel and its position. Any owner can track through this system. It is all interconnected, whether your vessel is in Lakshadweep or in Andamans, you can track it by sitting at Delhi. So similarly, we have other systems like radar transponders. Any vessel can identify itself with help of the radar transponder, how especially for fixing its own position, accurate real-time position. So these do matter because you need a certainty of your cargo handling, that it reaches to its destination. For that, even world community has taken care of it. Those especially poor nations, even better nations, are able to helping them to establish such an important this aids to marine navigation Even India is one of the major contributor to your Malacca and Singapore highway. That Malacca Straits, India contributes almost $1 million per year to that Indonesia and Malaysia, Singapore, that these people maintain for maintaining the aids to marine navigation. Of course, other countries also contribute here. So, idea is to have safe and efficient marine navigation of the vessel, and how much and how DGLL has been doing, keeping the things up to date, that will be clear in this present film. Little entertainment as well.
India is a vast South Asian country with diverse terrain. From Himalayan peaks to Indian Ocean coastline and history reaching back 5 millennia, it has a land frontier of 15,200 kilometers and a coastline of 7,517 kilometers. India has plenty of mineral resources, which include gold, iron ore, manganese ore, mica, bauxite, chromites, natural gas, diamonds, limestone, and thorium. India is also famous for the great Indian spices, which include a variety of spices grown across the Indian subcontinent. In 1497, the Portuguese navigator Vasco da Gama rounded the Cape of Good Hope and became the first European to sail to India. This discovery ignited the Indian commercial trade in 15th century itself. As time advanced, the trading increased between nations. The number of vessels and voyage also increased, and since there were no effective aids to navigation, this led to many unexpected mishaps. This caused evolution of aids to marine navigation. The Directorate General of Lighthouses and Lightships provides general aids to marine navigation along the Indian coast, which includes lighthouses, lightships, buoys, recon, DGPS, NAIS, etc. In India, 85 to 90% of imports and exports is carried by ships, as being the cheapest mode of transportation, and it is mostly performed in western coast. Presently, more than 600 ships of various sizes, including VLCCs, LPGs, large Capesize bulk carriers, etc., arrive in Gulf of Kutch every month, and this number is constantly increasing. The main ports in Gulf of Kutch are Kandla, Mundra, Sikka, Rosi, Badinar, Navlaki, Okha, Jakhon, Koteshwar, and Tuna Port. Kandla and Mundra are the major ports, and Sikka, even though not a major port, handle large quantities of cargo, crude oil, LPG, and chemicals. Due to the topography of Gulf of Kutch, new parts are also coming up. The channel in Gulf of Kutch is very narrow to accommodate the vessels coming inside Gulf of Kutch. More than 60% of nation's crude is transported through this channel. If any mishaps happen in the mouth of Gulf of Kutch, the entire operation will be affected. Therefore, it was necessary for traffic management system in this area. Extending our responsibility towards safe navigation along Indian waters and to address the long-pending issue of coastal security in terms of monitoring vessels entering the porous Gulf of Kutch, Directorate General of Lighthouses and Lightships established Vessel Traffic Service in Gulf of Kutch. The world's first harbour surveillance radar was inaugurated in Liverpool, England in July 1948, and in March 1950, a radar surveillance system was established at Long Beach, California, the first such system in the United States. Later, these have been evolved as VTS systems. In Gulf of Kutch, the vessel traffic service plays an important role in guiding. With completion of the scheme, an orderly traffic in the entire Gulf of Kutch is ensured, which has mitigated the risk to human lives at sea, severity of accidents and environmental pollution in congested waterways of the Gulf of Kutch. The VTS system has been built by Directorate General of Lighthouses and Lightships at the cost of 165 crores with financial partnership of Kandla Port Trust and Gujarat Maritime Board. It was inaugurated and dedicated to nation on 13th February 2012. VTS Gulf of Kutch is the largest VTS system in India and one of the largest VTS in the world in terms of coverage area, which is more than 16,000 square kilometers. The VTS system comprises of most modern equipments such as Axon S-band radars, radio direction finders, automatic identification system, and meteorological sensors to enable efficient operation of VTS. The VTS Gulf of Kutch constitutes 9 radar stations at Koteshwar, Jakhong, Chachi, Mandavi, Navinal, Kandla, Balachari, Chudeshwar, Okha, 3 repeater stations at Haruri, Vanku, and Bhadreshwar, 6 port monitoring stations at Navalaki Port, Kandla Port, Rosibanda Port, Sik, Kandla, Navinal and Jakhong. This can accurately provide AIS information of all vessels sailing across the Gulf of Kutch. Meteorological sensors meant for collecting meteorological information about conditions over sea. The main services provided by the VTS Gulf of Kutch are Information Service, Traffic Organization Service and Navigational Assistance Service. Information Service. This ensures that essential information such as weather conditions, meteorological information, etc. become available in good time for onboard decision making. Traffic Organization Service. This prevents the development of dangerous maritime traffic situations and to provide for safe and efficient movement of vessel traffic within the VTS area. Navigational Assistance Service. This is a service to assist onboard navigational decision making and to monitor its effects. The VTS Gulf of Kutch is divided into 4 sectors. VTS operators perform operations in the respective sectors. Once a vessel enters in VTS area, it is guided through all sectors until it reaches its port limit, then handed over to port signal stations for port operations. After that, the same is taken over by VTS, then VTS will take command of the vessel maneuver until it leaves the VTS area. Vessels entering Gulf of Kutch may be destined to different major or minor ports along the Gulf of Kutch. They are required to send their pre-arrival and departure notifications to VTS through email. This is mandatory and published in Admiral List of Radio Signals, Volume 6/4. The VTS provides information to the vessels in respective sectors through VHF, and the vessels are to inform while entering as well as leaving each sector. The VTS provides seamless surveillance of the entire Gulf of Kutch up to 19 nautical miles for radar targets of radar cross section, which is of 50 square meter and measured at 3 meters height. Radar and AIS integrated targets are received at each VTS consoles. Thereby, the operator can attain the accurate position, course, speed, draft, IMO number, call sign, MMSI code and other information of particular vessel. This assists the operator to perform his job of guiding the vessels. For operating VTS round the clock, experienced supervisors and operators are deployed under VTS manager. Also, a well-trained technical team by DGLL is working 24/7 to extend technical support for the VTS. VTS thus makes its impact over Gulf of Kutch by improvement in safety of traffic, improvement of efficiency of traffic, optimized traffic flow, providing information to the competent authorities about movements of ships carrying hazardous, dangerous, and noxious cargo on board. In case of a pollution incident, early detection can be performed. Aids to coastal surveillance and security monitoring. Ever since its commission, the VTS Gulf of Kutch has been the silent contributor towards safe marine navigation in the Gulf of Kutch. The continuous monitoring in the area has been number of lives have been saved due to the active participation and the invaluable assistance provided during search and rescue operations. The VTS has been the eyes and ears for the security agencies and has contributed towards the security of the nation. VTS Gulf of Kutch is serving the nation with assistance in safe navigation and providing enhanced coastal security.
This is one of the interactive systems of aids to marine navigation, with where operators continue to be in touch of the vessels. But there are other systems, as I told, differential global positioning systems, as well as automatic identification systems, radar beacons, and visual lighthouses. They are not interactive, but they are contributing to the safe navigation and so that vessels can sail to their destination in a shorter time, faster way, efficient way, without meeting any dangers. That's the motto. And it helps ultimate and adds to the certainty of the desire of the business, whatever is intended for. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mishra. It was very informative, and at least for me, for instance, this was totally new kind of thing, and how it helps in the smoother conduct of transport vessels. Thank you. And now I'll request Mr. Swaminathan from Balmer, Lawrie to make his small presentation.
Yeah, session chairman, keynote speaker, eminent speakers on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. On the subject of development of logistics infrastructure, I am restricting myself to three areas: container freight station, cold chain logistics, and warehousing. Multimodal logistic hub is slated to be taken up in the next session, so as such I am not covering that. Importance of logistics. Efficient logistics obviously drives growth. We have seen in the example of Amazon and Flipkart. Logistic industry is the backbone of development. Of course, all of us know about that. It generates an employment of about 2.5 crore of people. India is right now ranked 44th in the list of 160 countries, which was obviously an improvement compared to what it was in 2014. And logistic infra is very important to ensure that the buyer and seller is well connected and at the best possible pace. Indian economy has been growing, of course, as you know all, between 5 and 6% in the last couple of years. It was 8.2% in 2016. Ours is a 2.7 trillion economy, $2.7 trillion. And at this point of time, we are seventh in the world as far as the size is concerned. And obviously, we want to move to top five. Merchandise exports, both exports and imports, came down in the last 5 months. Infrastructure sector, of course, you all know as to what it all includes. So, bridges, dams, roads, urban development. Last 10 years, we have seen so much of improvement in this infrastructure. National highways, in terms of kilometers, they doubled. Indian Railways carried 40% more cargo. Ports registered a growth of 45%. And a lot of investments are being made in the infrastructure sector. And now I am going specifically to container freight station. I'm sure some of you know as to what it is. It's basically an extension of port and it's a customs notified area. It facilitates basically a cargo decongestion at the port. It's a decongestion. And it's an intermediate storage location between the port and the ultimate consignee or the consumer or the factory. And customs verification, customs checking, clearance are all done in a much better environment compared to a port. And there's a better linkage between container freight station and the port or the airport. And typically the charges for handling a container in a container freight station is much lower compared to what a port charges. And typically you have the reefer points available in the container freight station or ICDs, which helps in retaining the power for refrigerator containers. And typically 10% of the total Exim cargo is handled by the container freight stations. And at this point of time in India, about 190 CFS are in operation, or in the sense, although number of CFS are more, they are in operation, 190. And it generates employment for about a lakh of people, and they handle about 5 million TEUs. And the concept of container freight station started in late 80s, almost 89. And between 90 and 2010, there were a plethora of CFS set up in India. And primarily the intention was that, you will have to decongest the port, and the port should ideally evacuate the containers within a couple of days of the arrival of the ship. And the central government also gave a lot of incentives for setting up of container station. And you have both public sector and private sector operators in this particular industry. So as I said, 2010, it was 171 CFS, and in 2019, it is 224. So the pace of growth of CFS has come down in the last 10 years. And probably in the next few slides, I'm going to say that it'll probably even come down in the next, say, 10 years. And all these container freight stations together have a turnover of around, say, 4,100 crores. And ICDs, I'll explain what is ICD a little later, and that's about 2,100 crores. And Chennai, Calcutta, and Mumbai put together account for almost 55 to 60% of the total CFS turnover. And the growth in non-major ports is higher than the growth in the major ports. Major ports are around 12, and the rest of the ports are called non-major ports. And the growth in non-major ports is obviously much higher. And today, the non-major ports handle about 48% of the total traffic. And three states, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, and Gujarat, have together 56% of the total number of CFS. In three states alone, 56% of the total number of CFS are located. Totally 327 CFS / ICDs were granted permission by the IMC, Interministerial Committee, out of which 288 are in operation. The West Coast, as the session chairman said at the beginning, they handle almost 70% of the container traffic. And CFS ICD, I have already talked about that. And CONCOR alone has control over 72 CFS and ICDs. And 21% of the CFS is actually in landlocked states like Bihar, UP types. Private freight terminal is another concept where this facilitates basically movement of traffic by rail. And this was established as a scheme. It was set up in 2015. And at this point of time, there are 58 PFTs in India. And 100% FDI is allowed in this particular segment. The growth of CFS and ICD in the last, say, few years was primarily on account of general growth in the Exim traffic. And ports also have handled a much more volume because of the operationalization of more and more ports. And this launch of Sagarmala, which actually is basically to connect the 7,500 kilometers of coastline, has also helped boost the industry. And Bharatmala, which again is going to be a 5 trillion rupee investment, and the phase one expected to be completed by 2022, is also expected to give a push to this particular industry. And typically in India, the containerized cargo as a percentage was much lower, say about 20, 30 years back. Now it's come to about, say, 40% level, 40, 50% level. And that also has helped in the growth of this industry. And then the construction of DFC, both on the west and the east corridor, is likely to help in terms of growth of this particular business. The challenge, you know, what we have been facing in the last, say, couple of years as far as this particular business is concerned is because of the push by the government for the direct port deliveries. And well, the government probably thought that the cost of logistic has gone up because of an intermediary like container freight station being put into service. Although originally, you know, the concept of CFS was with the noble objective of allowing more and more faster evacuation of the containers from the port. But over a period of time, it was found that a cargo which gets delivered directly from the port versus a cargo getting delivered via a CFS, this latter one was costing more to the consignee. So they felt that we should push more and more direct port deliveries. And this particular aspect can ensure that there is no need for a CFS at all over a period of time. And typically, the approval process takes a long time. Sometimes it takes even up to a year. And today, because of the plethora of CFS in some cities, there is a very high level of cutthroat competition. This direct port delivery is definitely a cause for concern for the existence of CFS. See, unfortunately, a country like India, the ports are all in many places at the center of the city, and it cannot really handle larger volume, it cannot expand. So the concept of CFS did make sense at one particular point of time, that the moment the containers arrive through a ship, it will be moved to some CFS and it will be decongested. And the delivery from CFS was always much easier compared to a delivery from a port. But this push by the government is now actually witnessing a high level of direct deliveries from the port. 50% is the direct delivery now from, say, Mumbai port, from JNPT. And in Chennai, it is around 36%. Calcutta, it's around 42% at this point of time. And government wants to take it to around 70% in the next couple of years. So it looks as if those CFS operators who are not up to it may be ejected out of the system. And newer investments in this particular industry may come down sharply. The survival of CFS, of course, obviously depends on the level of infrastructure development in the country. And we expect that, since infrastructure is being given a push, there will be definitely some scope for CFS, at least in some port areas where the ports are not in a position to develop beyond a point. And CFS obviously will have to realign themselves. If they are not getting the port volume, they will have to probably have more warehousing space to ensure that they remain above water. And they have to definitely think in terms of a different business model. And they can probably, have a storage yard or a tank farm or a silos. ICD is basically an inland container depot. It's a dry port, which of course, Session Chairman spoke about when he gave his speech. And ICDs are typically away from the port city. This actually helps the customers who are away from the port also to get the benefit of port deliveries in a way. And typically the functions which ICD does is very similar to what CFS does. They receive and deliver cargo, stuffing and destuffing happens, custom clearance happens there, consolidation and deconsolidation also happen there. The difference between ICD and CFS is that CFS is a customs notified area, but it's not a customs station. It is actually always under a customs station, whereas ICD is a customs station by itself. You can have a bill of lading directly consigned in the name of one ICD. Multimodal logistics I'm not touching because it's being covered in the next session. Warehousing industry, I have only another 3-4 slides. Warehousing industry is typically $160 billion is of course the logistic industry, out of which 25% accounts for around the warehousing industry, which is about $40 billion. And unorganized sector at this point of time still holds a huge market share, about almost 90% of the share. And organized warehousing is typically with public sector companies like FCI, Central Warehousing Corporation, State Warehousing Corporation, like that. And warehousing space as such per se was 104 million square feet in 2015. Now it has jumped to 209 million square feet. And growth in grade A warehousing has been better, which means obviously better quality warehouses are now being set up, and that growth is better compared to grade B, which means that the share of the organized warehousing is improving by the day. Occupancy levels also are superb. In the last year, it was almost 90% average. The growth drivers are typically the per capita income goes up. So obviously there's a more demand for, say, processed foods. Incomes are growing at a brisk pace in the country. And supply, basically, you know, the supply side also, there has been a lot of growth. There is genetically modified seed, favorable climate for agriculture, increased mechanization, which obviously increased the supply per se. So obviously the demand for warehouses has gone up. And there are some, private players are also entering. Fair price shop, typically, I don't think any of us now go to a fair price shop to buy anything. E-commerce, I have discussed at the beginning. They obviously are a major player in this industry, and their total requirement of space is about 48% of the total demand in the country. So which means they almost use 50% of the total space. The issues and challenges in this particular industry is that information, there is no proper information available about the availability of warehousing space in the country. You have been in a asymmetric fashion only you get the data. Inadequate nationwide common enforcement agency. Every warehouse is actually built according to one's own choices. There is no standardization there. And warehousing is not distributed across the country on a need basis. In one, there are some localized factors. In some places you have more, some places you don't have at all. So this sort of a mismatch is there. And you don't have also a proper infrastructure to handle transportation and particularly the heavyweight cargo, because the roads are not all that of a high quality. And then it's a capital intensive, and typically the break even or the payback is much later. It takes more times, at least 7-8 years. Now we come to the last point, which is basically on the cold storage. As of December 17, the total cold storage number was around 7,845. The total capacity is around 35 million tons. Of that, 5,367 only are functional. Region-wise, the maximum installed capacity is in North. Uttar Pradesh alone is the single largest in terms of a state, in terms of capacity. Eastern and Western regions have 23 and 11%. Government, of course, provides grant. If you are going through certain investments in this cold storage, government provides subsidy. And it's again a fragmented industry. Out of this, there are 3,500 companies handling 7845 capacity, you can understand. And very few players are actually able to offer end-to-end. And as you all know, the high cost of logistics in India is primarily because there is a lot of wastage. About 50,000 crore of rupees is wasted in the country on a year-to-year basis on the fruits and vegetables, and also in terms of the vaccines. 20% of the vaccines are getting wasted because it could not maintain the level of temperature required to maintain it. The drivers of cold storage is that there is some incentive coming from the government. Industrial growth itself is there. And processed foods, it's being consumed much more in these days. And retail is getting much more organized. And quick service restaurants we see now in BCDs and seed cities also. And pharma always requires cold storage. And the last slide I have is on the challenges of cold storage. High operation costs compared to countries in the West. Land acquisition is always an issue in India. And again, like as I said about warehouse, the cold storages are not spread out in India in a proper way. You have more in some place and then hardly any in some other states. And you don't have a proper infrastructure to carry reefer containers. And some states, of course, charge excess also for you know, this cold chains, you know, the electricity charges are much different, and it also has a very high payback and low return. Yeah, with that, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
CILT organizers to please put this on their website, host this presentation on the website, because many of us may be interested in following it further. At this stage, I'd like to invite Mr. Reddy, Keshav Reddy, the doyen of warehousing, because we have just we are on the subject on warehousing. NDR is a very big name. They are the pioneer, and many sitting here would know, in fact, the first private ICD was actually conceived by Mr. Reddy. There were problems because of which they couldn't make it and somebody else made it, but it was conceived, is now into FTWZ in a very big manner, and they have made many terminals which have now, in partnership with DP World, they are being run. Mr. Reddy.
Thank you very much for Mr. Gupta ji. And Gupta ji and myself started with the Gadi Harsru when his CONCOR agreement there. He also one of the party in that, in the game plan, in the rest of other inland waterways and the coming up in the DFC corridor, cargo corridor is coming in Indian market. And thanks for this opportunity created by the team members, and mainly visioners what need of the country. I hope whatever I know little language, in my own language, I can convey to the synergy. Now, like this Bhushan Lawrie and Mr. Gupta ji told for the problems of this energy, I also can tell some solutions. Some of the railway officials is there in the here. And the main concept from the discharge, port discharge, we are very well versed. We are come out in the extraordinary stage presently. But from discharge to taking out the cargo, it is taking delay. In that, railways can give a connectivity to the terminals. And from there, integrated terminal concept come to the Indian market. It can be give a lot of saving, like 13% to the 9 to 8%, whatever our existing terminology is available, we can do this fashion of the Indian market. In addition to that, whatever require FTWZ, SCZ, and a small industrial park, customer base already FDI given a clearance from the government. We want to give all under one roof, mainly for agriculture product. After China, we are the number two, but on our exports compared to China, we are not in the race. Because of the integrated logistics parts, it can become under one roof and give the everything under one roof can give milestone. One is the cost reduction take place, quality is improved substantially. The reason 4 or 5 places the same product is handling, and end, for example, in India doing presently our export business on LC. After the reaching the place, lot of rejection, 10% rejection taking place on present standard. I want to do it on first trial base in Ennore. For the FTWZ, I give all labs under one roof. Whoever buyer, they can see the approach in the quality and verification then and there. And from there, he buy. Because one small example I can give in agriculture product, you can give sell of the product in Indian territory. Very nominal cost you can give the buyer. Buyer feel very comfortably after reaching either you or them to spend the money. Once you give the Indian territory for the cargo, cargo give a lot of realization in the approach. And the buyer feel very cheap is coming from Indian market, why not I buy? But unfortunately, FTWZ creation on those type of a synergy come to Indian market, a big revolution may change place in the approach on agriculture and the cargo of the small scale industries and medium scale industries. Whoever manufacturing raw material suppliers can come in Indian territory and there keep it a stock, and there can deliver on the product on the consumption based delivery. It can be improved on re-export also in a big way. I can give a small example on second-hand cars. We are not exporting compared to other countries. We can do the same model of creation on FTWZ, can do the creation of the approach. They are already paid on one-sided duty. Re-export is allowed in the country in the base. It is a big demand and supply. We are not, as I seen all over world, we are not have any negative modules not there. Whatever there, Mr. Guptaji knows in the Vision and mainly credit this rail corridor is coming up in Indian market. This require only one roof of the solution and give the total economy in the under one roof. We are much economical and basically you take agriculture product. We are much cheaper than the world market. But we want to give all under one roof. We can definitely give a much cheaper than the world market in a competitive war. In that requirement is there in all under one roof. Like Bamal Lawrie mentioned there in cold storage, FTWZ, in whatever foreign investor coming labs, quality checking, everything before loading of the container take place. We can get a lot of revolutionary model can take place in the Indian economy. I hope we can see the future day on that model. I am there in this industry more than 30, 40 years. I know the industry growth taken place in a different angle. I want to see this angle in the approach. That is why in this forum, I am bringing a small, what I know, a layman presentation I've given. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Reddy. Can I now request Mr. Shukla, member traffic, Indian Waterway Authority, to share his thoughts with us?
Respected chairman of the session and the audience, good morning to all of you. The inland waterways is though the oldest mode of transport. Now it is coming up in the recent few years in a new garb, and we are augmenting the capacity of inland waterways. Various rivers which are navigable, lot of interventions and various projects are being undertaken. And I will be sharing the current development and the plans of Inland Waterways Authority of India, which is responsible for the development of national waterways in India. Basically, some of the priorities national waterways are part of this presentation, and in case there is some more queries, we can address later. So Inland Waterways Authority, though it was established in 1986, quite long back, but the development is taking place in last 4-5 years, and there is a focused approach, and the industry is also responding quite well to the various interventions and infrastructure development which are taking place. We had 5 national waterways till 2014, and in 2016, 106 additional waterways have been declared as a national waterways. So once they are declared as a national waterways, IWI gets jurisdiction. Inland Waterways Authority gets jurisdiction for its development. So when I say development, means we take up fairway development, make rivers navigable, and we take up some infrastructure projects. Development of terminals, navigational aids, channel marking, and all those things so that the transportation can take place on the national waterways. With the declaration of 111 national waterways, we have around 20,000 kilometers of waterways for development. But the current focus is on 5,000 kilometers of waterways. And as we all know, the mode of transport, the water transport is cheapest, and it is environment friendly also. But it has its own challenges. That is the reason why the share, as chairman has also mentioned, is not that good. It's not substantial, including coastal shipping. We have a share of around 5-6%, out of which inland waterways is 2.5%. The growth, what is now being, we are seeing in inland waterways as well as coastal shipping and some of the recent movements which are happening, they are though very encouraging. And if we go by that standard, we are quite hopeful that this sector will get substantial share. So not substantial, then also at least 10 to 12% share in maybe in few years, and it can be developed as an alternate mode of transport along with the rail and road. This is the current cargo matrix, and we have 72 million ton of cargo, which is around 2.5% of the total logistic total cargo which is being handled in India. And most of the cargo comes from Gujarat and Maharashtra, which are some national waterways like Amba, Tapi. They are connecting ports. So wherever the national waterways are connecting port and there is some industry in the nearby the national waterway, it makes a perfect combination, and that is where the cargo picks up very fast. Considering that in mind, we are now developing other rivers which can connect port with the hinterland. And Ganga also is showing a very good growth. Last year we had around 5.48 million ton, now it is 7 million, approximately 7 million ton, and we may cross this year around 10 million ton. Likewise, Brahmaputra is also being developed. So, but most of the cargo is in the bulk. That is where the National Waterways has the edge over the road and other modes of transport. However, the container transportation is also now being encouraged and it's taking place. Recently, the first containerized movement is going to Brahmaputra. So last year we had on Ganga, and this time, in this year, November, Secretary Shipping inaugurated the containerized movement. That movement is still in Bangladesh. That vessel is still in Bangladesh, and it is sailing smoothly. So it's loaded with 2.1 meter draft with 48 TUs. And it is going to be received in Guwahati in 2-3 days. So this is the new initiative which has taken place, and we feel that this is going to be a regular movement, because there is a lot of cargo which goes to near and around Brahmaputra from Haldia and Kolkata region. Jalmarg Vikas project is our flagship program, which is supported by World Bank, and it is 5,369 crore program, which was approved by cabinet in 2018, and it has all the components of infrastructure. So we are developing multimodal terminals. Varanasi terminal and Sahibganj terminals were inaugurated by Honorable Prime Minister. One was last year, and the Sahibganj was inaugurated in September this year. The dredging contracts have been given in some of these stretches, and some other stretches also the contracts are going to be given. The dredging is now the going to be the assured depth dredging. So the LED of 2.5 meter or 3 meter, whatsoever we are showing in the graph in this slide, is going to be assured, because it is going to be under the with the private operator. There are certain penalty clauses also if the depth is not provided. Sahibganj has been inaugurated, and Haldia terminal is also going to be ready by January, February of to 2020. So all the three multimodal terminals will be ready. When I say multimodal, it is also having the rail connectivity. Its a plan is to connect with the rail also, but currently it is road connected. Rail connectivity will come in the second phase. Right now, Farakka and downstream, we are having around 4 million ton cargo, which is being handled by National Waterway 1. And upstream of Farakka, now because these terminals have come and the dredging has started, we are expecting good growth to come in near future, maybe another 1 or 2 years. Apart from Ganga, Brahmaputra is also one of the priority national waterway for us. And on Brahmaputra, we already have Pandu and Dhubri as terminals. Those are functional terminals. And as Mr. Gupta also in his inaugural remarks, he mentioned Jogigopa. There also we have a plan to have inland waterway terminal, which will be connected with multimodal logistic park, which is being developed by NHIDCL, the Ministry of Road and Transport. So Jogigopa will become a multimodal logistic hub, which can connect Bhutan, Meghalaya, Lower Assam, and this region as a aggregation of cargo. And as a cargo hub, because it has a good connectivity with waterways, as well as there is a NH which is also going to be expanded, and it is quite close to Bhutan. Likewise, we are developing River Barak, which is also in Assam, and we will have, the dredging has completed. We currently have 2 meter draft. And why we have taken Barak River also, because it connects through Bangladesh waterway system. With Bangladesh, we have agreement where our Indian vessels can also ply. So that is Indo-Bangladesh protocol route. That is why Barak makes lot of sense for the cargo transportation to Silchar area. And from that area, we can transport cargo to Manipur, Tripura, and Meghalaya, Mizoram. So that is one center which can also become a logistic hub. And there are National Highway Authority also have lot of development plan in that area, so that this will also get connected with waterways. So this is how the Brahmaputra and Barak River are going to serve us. And Indo-Bangladesh protocol route gets connected with NW1, that is Ganga, NW2, Brahmaputra, and NW16, that is Barak. So this waterway system, through Indo-Bangladesh protocol route, it makes a waterway grid kind of thing, which will be approximately 4,500 kilometers. So this 4,500 kilometers of waterway, starting from Varanasi, going to Dibrugarh in Assam, and other side in Silchar, this is going to be an integrated waterway corridor, which will have uniform draft of 2.5 meter with various terminals. So in Bangladesh also, we have 6 ports of call, which are going to be increased to 10 now. We have another meeting with them on 4th and 5th December, where we are going to increase the ports of call on both sides. But still we have Kolkata, Haldia, Pandu, Dhubri, Seelghat, and Karimganj, which is near Silchar, as a port of call in India. When I say port of call, means we can do the loading and unloading under custom supervision. Vessels can go and berth there. So these are the points from where the cargo can go through Bangladesh. But there is no bar on Indian vessels. Indian vessels can start from Varanasi and they can go up to Dibrugarh without any problem in Bangladesh. So that is what I was trying to say. This connectivity is going to be, it is established. That is how this pilot movements, which I mentioned, MV Maheshwari, I and Beki, that was the picture in the first slide. Which are on the way to Pandu. So this connectivity is already there. The only the commercials and technical viability are to be established. Kochi is already waterway, which is this Kerala waterway, which is around 250 kilometers, which is operational. We have 8 terminals, which are being used by cruises as well as the ODC movement, and Cochin port and Kottayam ports are also connected through these waterways. So there is a movement of containers which can happen between Kottayam and Kochi. Direct export can happen from Kottayam port to Kochi, Cochin port. Likewise, this is NW4 in Andhra Pradesh. Here we are developing 82 kilometers, which is around Amravati capital area, because there is a lot of demand of building material transportation and there is no bridge available. So Ro-Ro services are very popular there, and we had around 0.5 million ton cargo last year. And this region has a lot of potential. In phase two, we are going to develop, connect Vijayawada to Kakinada as well as Rajamundri Polavaram area. So this the blue, this green area and the blue area, this will get developed. So from here, because Kakinada port will also get connected, and from there through coastal shipping, a lot of movement of rice and grain can take place, which goes to northeast and other, and also exported out of India. So this is another interesting stretch where the development is taking place. As I mentioned this already, that Bangladesh, the government of India is spending around 300 crore for the dredging of rivers in Bangladesh. So from Sirajganj to Daikoa and Asuganj to Jakiganj, this stretch is not a tidal stretch. And here the dredging has already started, the contracts have been given, and it's 7 years assured 2.5 meter contract, so that the connectivity with northeast is assured. So because in inland waterways, the reliability used to be the biggest challenge. The industry used to say that sometimes the draft may not be available, so if they are investing in barges, it may go idle. So that is why the assured depth concept has been brought in, and 2.5 meter will be provided in Bangladesh also. The Bangladesh government is on board throughout the year. And government of India is spending money on this, and 80% cost will be met by us. These are the new ports of call which are going to be declared in Bangladesh as well as India. So Badarpur, Tribeni, Kolaghat. Kolaghat is also on River Rupnarayan, which gets connected through this waterway, Indo-Bangladesh protocol. It's between Kolkata and Haldia. There is a river called Rupnarayan. So that is also an industrial area. So there are a lot many thermal power plants and cement companies. They can use Rupnarayan River and they can take fly ash or other material which is cement, and they can also bring coal through inland waterways of Rupnarayan, and through Bangladesh it can take to northeast as well. Yeah, so I have only one more slide. This is the new development. Prime Minister Bangladesh and India has signed in October, where the Chattogram and Mongla port can be used for the transportation of goods to northeast. There are four points of entry and exit which can be used by sea mode also. This is Bangladesh traffic scenario. One more thing is that how Nepal will get connected through inland waterways. So because NW1 is being developed and the treaty between India and Nepal is being amended, so that the cargo from Calcutta and Haldia, all containers can come directly up to Sahibganj, Kaluhat and Varanasi terminals, and they will get connected through these custom points. So Birganj and Viratnagar, all those places are going to be connected through waterways. The Myanmar, it is still in development. So Haldia, from Haldia to Sitwe port has already been developed. It also connects to northeast region. I'm just telling how the eastern part will get connected through national waterways. Like Bhutan, I have already told. These are the pictures of some pilot movements to establish the technical and commercial viability. And we have already come out with the figures which we are going to put on website, which makes this mode of transportation quite competitive. Thank you. Thank you so much for all your attention. Thank you.
Hello. It shows a great future, and I'm sure I also congratulate you for success in Pandu, which is really very big success. We've been looking at it for many years, and now this first consignment of 45 containers. I just hope that through Sundarban you would not have any problem, and transits of loaded containers will be taken care of. I'm sure you would have already worked out all those arrangements. Now, can I request Mr. Roy from JM Bakshi Group? JM Bakshi Group, as we all know, is one of the oldest groups in the country, freight forwarding, shipping, now terminal management, ICD management. They're involved in all. I remember DMRC when it imported first. Metro coaches, they were there, they were the one who brought these coaches here. So we'd like to hear from Mr. Roy, his comments on infra in general and port infrastructure in particular, whether the steps being taken offer a lot of promise or do something more, some more policy push-ups need to be given. I'll request you to keep it short for and finish in 5 minutes, because I think you've taken the time of other session. Okay. We'd like to conclude as early as possible.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the time. I'm sorry I don't have a presentation. I was expecting more of a discussion. I will touch a little bit on coastal shipping. We are all aware that the port infrastructure has been developed in this country in a reasonably good form. There are concession agreements in place. There are model concession agreements in place. Of course, there is also certain, let's say, challenges. But however, the port infrastructure has been, by and large, designed for exim cargo. Okay. We have been talking about seamless movement. I've heard all my colleagues talk about various aspects of things, and I would like to differentiate the the two cargoes. One is the Exim cargo and one is the domestic cargo. I think both require a little bit of different treatment, and it is very important for us to understand the basic difference. Exim cargo, by and large, is moved because of an international environment, an environment in which it is already packed and being transported internationally. Domestic cargo is not so. Coming to the coastal cargo, which is primarily going to be domestic cargo, the need of the hour, in my opinion, is to have small terminals, 100 crore terminals, spread across the coastline, free of customs, well connected to the road and rail network. That, I think, is going to be very important. Policies are being worked towards that. The Sagarmala policy, in particular, goes towards that. And I think that would be a good this thing. I'm happy to take any questions specific to this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Roy. Now I'll request Mr. Agarwal, the most familiar face. I think everybody in the audience would recognize Mr. Agarwal, the pioneer in movement of household cargo and express cargo all over India. His comments on I'll be very happy to know his comments on the road infrastructure that is being developed, because he's very intricate with the road, and I think his market share of cargo in the organized sector is very, very high. Mr. Agarwal.
Thank you, Sunilji. First of all, I'm thankful for CILT platform, jinhone ye itni badiya conference bulai aur ek food for thought diya, logistic cost Hindustan ki kaise kam kare aur kaise iske andar improve kare. Main aaj is pari ka last batsman hu, to last batsman to jaldi out ho jata hai, to main aapka tajriba se main nahi lunga. Kai baar jam bhi jata hai magar main samay zyada nahi lunga. Sir ne kaha ki road transport or surface transport ek usme kya challenge hai, logistic cost kaise kis tarah se kam ho sakti hai, possible means se. मैं एक बार आपको याद दिलाता हूँ, 70-80 साल पहले जब वेसल में सामान आता था और उस टाइम पर ये कंटेनर नहीं होते थे, तो आप एक कल्पना करो कि कैसे आता होगा. उसमें ही कपड़ा, उसमें ही कोयला, उसमें ही फूड, उसमें ही फार्मा, सब एक वेसल में आता था, बम्बे आकर उतरता था. उतरने के बाद वो फिर सेग्रीगेट होकर छोटी छोटी गाड़ियों में जाता होगा, कोई राजामुंदरी, कोई कलकत्ता, कोई गुवाहाटी, कोई हैदराबाद. तो उस टाइम कम से कम 35-40% सामान खराब हो जाता था, या फिर उसको झेलना पड़ता था. चलो कोई बात नहीं, होता ही है ऐसे. ऐसा एक सीन हमारे होता था, और किसी महापुरुष ने फिर कहा कि ये इससे कैसे निजागत मिले, तो देन 20 फीट और 40 फीट के कंटेनर का जन्म हुआ. ये हमारे सी का एक फेस बदला. हमने उसी को एक बार रेप्लीकेट किया. हमने सोचा कि ये जैसे वहाँ होता है, वैसे भी ही आज इंडिया में हमारे सरफेस ट्रांसपोर्ट में भी होता है. एक बड़ी गाड़ी, जो जनरली यू मस्ट हैव सीन द ट्रेलर, बड़ी गाड़ी तो 32 फीट मल्टी एक्सल या सिंगल एक्सल, क्योंकि सब लॉजिस्टिक से जुड़े हुए हैं, तो गाड़ी की एक आपके पिक्चर दिमाग में आ जाएगी. और जो लेस देन ट्रक लोड होते हैं, जिसको पार्सल कहते हैं, एक्सप्रेस वे कहते हैं, वो एक बड़ी गाड़ी में 16 टन मटेरियल लेके जाते हैं, और कम से कम 40-50 क्लाइंट्स का माल जाता है. 40-50 कंसाइनमेंट उसमें जाते हैं, 40-50. और उसके अंदर उसी जो वेसल की तरह है, उसी में फूड भी होगा, फार्मा भी होगा, खाने का सामान भी होगा, कपड़े भी होंगे, डिफरेंट डिफरेंट सामान होगा. और वो एक जगह से दूसरी जगह जाता है, बिकॉज ट्रांसपोर्टर क्या करता है कि लोड वेट लॉस ना हो और वॉल्यूम लॉस ना हो, तो वो कोशिश करता है कि नीचे सामान, थोड़ा सा हैवी सामान नीचे लोड करे और लाइट सामान ऊपर लोड करे, ताकि उसकी 16 टन कैपेसिटी भी बन जाए, और 2200 क्यूबिक फीट जिस तरह की उसकी वॉल्यूम होती है वो भी उसकी बरकरार रहे. और इस तरह से वो एक जगह से दूसरी जगह लेके जाते हैं, और फिर वहाँ उतारेंगे. उस उतारने के बाद पहले तो कलेक्शन होता है, फिर वो लेके एक जगह पर कंसोलिडेट होगा, उसके बाद वो लेकर जाएंगे, फिर अनलोड करेंगे, फिर डिस्ट्रीब्यूट होगा. तो उसी साज की तरह आज हिंदुस्तान के अंदर भी वो जो सामान लोडिंग अनलोडिंग, जिसको हम जनरली ट्रांसशिपमेंट कहते हैं, आपको सरप्राइज होगा,
there is 42,000 crore annually loss because of this transshipment. 42,000 crore ka hamare Hindustan mein nuksan hota hai. Yadi hum isko hi rok le to 14% ki GDP ka kuch na to kuch 1-2% to niche aayega. Magar hum ye mante hain ki this is not unavoidable. Jab aap aadha truck lekar jaoge, aap 1/4 truck lekar jaoge, aap uska 1/10 truck lekar jaoge to aapka transshipment to hoga hi. वो कैसे आपको पूरा ट्रक आपके घर पे दे देगा? यदि मैं कहूं कि 5 पैसेंजर जा रहे हैं जहाज के अंदर पूरी और उनको कहें कि आप उसी भाड़े में मैं एक चार्टर्ड फ्लाइट दे देता हूं, हाउ डू यू फील? आप किसी एयरलाइंस में पूरी में एक फ्लाई कर रहे हो तो मैं कहता हूं 5 लोग यदि इकट्ठे हो जाए तो मैं कहता हूं एक चार्टर्ड दे देता हूं उसी भाड़े में, तो विल यू प्रेफर? यू विल प्रेफर. और ये कहूं कि 10% कम में दूंगा तो फिर तो कहोगे जी 1 घंटा पहले आके बैठ जाएंगे, बिकॉज कितनी खुशी होती है. तो दोस्तों ऐसा ही एक मॉडल हमने सपना लिया कि इसी तरह 1/4, 1/10, आधा, 1/3 उनके लिए एक चार्टर्ड फ्लाइट की तरह एक चार्टर्ड कंटेनर दे दें. आपका ताला, आपकी चाबी आप ही लगाओ, आप ही खोलो और डेस्टिनेशन के ऊपर जितने दिन रखना चाहे आप रखो, 3 हफ्ते तक नो चार्ज और 10% कम भाड़ा दे दो. लोगों ने कहा कि ये क्या है जादू, मतलब ये जादू पॉसिबल है. एक थॉट की जरूरत थी. अल्टीमेटली हमने फिर क्या किया सर, 500 केजी से ऊपर के डिफरेंट टाइप के कंटेनर बना दिए. द साइज इज 2.5 फीट, 4 फीट, 6 फीट, 8 फीट, 10 फीट, 12 फीट, ऑल ISO जो कॉटन मेटल के बनते हैं, कॉटन स्टील के, वैसे ही कंटेनर बना दिए. एक 40 फीट के ट्राले पर या एक 32 फीट के ट्राले के ऊपर 5-6 लोड कर दिए और कहा कि आप आपके घर में भरकर लाएंगे, एक जगह कंसोलिडेट करेंगे, इसी तरह ये एक डेस्टिनेशन पे जाएंगे, वहाँ पे डिस्ट्रीब्यूट होंगे. तो जिसके कारण जो एक प्रॉब्लम थी 42,000 करोड़ की और जिसकी ट्रांसिमेंट के डैमेज का जो एक बहुत बड़ा पर्सन चिन्ह बना हुआ था, वी हैव ट्राई टू जीरो इट. तो उसका नाम दिया इस कंसेप्ट का ट्रांसपोर्टेशन थ्रू ट्रकिंग क्यूब. दैट मीन्स लाइक यू मस्ट हैव हर्ड FTL, फुल ट्रक लोड, लेस देन ट्रक लोड, एक्सप्रेस कार्गो. एक नया सेगमेंट हमने तैयार किया है हाउस होल्ड की बजाय उसके साथ साथ, दैट इज कॉल्ड ट्रकिंग क्यूब सर्विस, TC सर्विस. ट्रकिंग क्यूब हमने नाम दिया, दैट इज कंटेनर ऑफ कोर्स बट वी हैव गिवन अ न्यू नेम, TC सर्विस. ट्रकिंग क्यूब के मतलब डिफरेंट टाइप के कंटेनर आपके एक जगह से भरेंगे दूसरी जगह जाएंगे. वो सी वाला सपना था जहाँ कंसोलिडेट के खराब होता था, वो सरफेस के ऊपर खराब होना हमने खत्म कर दिया. फिर सोचा कि और कैसे रेट कम करें. आप जितनी बार यदि इफ यू थिंक अबाउट एक ग्राहक के शूज में पाँव रखकर जब कोई लॉजिस्टिक प्लेयर सोचता है तो वो क्या सोचता है कि मैं कैसे कम रेट करूं. एक लॉजिस्टिक ओनर के रूप में सोचता है तो क्या सोचता है कि मेरी बैलेंस शीट कैसे मैं बढ़िया करूं, वहां उसको बढ़ाने की सोचता है. अदरवाइज तो हमने कभी भी हमेशा यही सोचा कि ग्राहक की क्या इच्छा होती है. उसकी हमेशा इच्छा होती है कि रेट कम हो, सर्विस बढ़िया हो, आफ्टर सेल सर्विस मिले. ये 3 चीज ग्राहक को मिल गई तो ग्राहक इज हैप्पी. तो हमने हमेशा सोचा कि और कैसे कम करें. दोस्तों वी हैव सीन इट, लाइक आपने देखा होगा रोड के ऊपर जो ओपन ट्रक चलते हैं, प्लेटफार्म ट्रक चलते हैं जिसमें JCB, एस्कोर्ट, ट्रैक्टर, मोटर्स, इंडस्ट्रियल गुड्स, उसके अंदर दैट इज 1.25 लाख करोड़ का बिजनेस है. ये हमारे आउट ऑफ 8 लाख करोड़ सरफेस ट्रांसपोर्ट का बिजनेस है. 8 लाख करोड़ में से 1.6 करोड़ ट्रक्स है हमारे हिंदुस्तान के. बाकी डाटा तो यदि मैं बतलाऊँ तो यू विल गेट इन गूगल, सब डाटा अवेलेबल है. मैं उसमें ज़्यादा आपको टेबल नहीं कराऊँगा. 1,25,000 करोड़ में से 1,25,000 करोड़ में से आपके जो 71% ट्रक है, ओपन ट्रक्स जो 1,25,000 करोड़ का बिजनेस करते हैं, 71% ओपन ट्रक में से मिनिमम 4 फीट और मैक्सिमम 20 फीट का स्पेस खाली जाता है. यू मस्ट हैव सीन इट. एक JCB लोड कर देंगे तो आगे और पीछे 4 फीट आगे खाली पाएगा, 2 फीट पीछे खाली पाएगा. कोई भी जनरेटर लोड पाएगा 5 फीट या 6 फीट आगे पीछे खाली पाएगा. दिस इज वेस्टेज. 71% ऑफ द ट्रक्स हैविंग वेस्टेज मिनिमम 4 फीट और मैक्सिमम 20 फीट. हमने सोचा ये वेस्टेज क्यों, ये भी एक अनसरी का डीजल जलाती है पूरा न होकर 4 फीट का. तो वी हैड स्टार्ट यूटिलाइजिंग दैट वेस्टेज, क्योंकि हमारे पास क्या था, डिफरेंट साइज के कंटेनर थे. जितना वेस्टेज होता है उतना ही सामान का लोड किया, उस वेस्टेज को वहाँ पर फिलर कर दिया. 4 फीट है तो 4 फीट, 6 फीट है तो 6 फीट, 10 फीट है तो 10 फीट, 20 फीट है तो 20 फीट. और हुआ क्या, जिसका जो सामान जो फुल लोड दिया करता था JCB एंड मैनी कंपनीज, उनको कहा कि साहब ये वेस्टेज आ रहा है, हम आपका 10% कम करेंगे। बोले कैसे करोगे? बोले हम कर देंगे। 10% उनका कम किया, साथ में ले जाने वाले जो दूसरा सामान है 10% उनका कम किया, और 10% मेरी बैलेंस शीट अपने आप बढ़िया बन गई। और इस तरह से अपने आप के अंदर एक नया सेगमेंट्स हो गया कि ये वेस्टेज को कैसे जीरो करें। तो इस तरह के एक विचार यदि लॉजिस्टिक में हम सोचते रहते हैं, तो ये जो वेस्टेज है हमारी जो दिखती नहीं, और हम ये सोचते हैं कि तो हो भी नहीं सकता, इम्पॉसिबल है, बट इट्स ऑल पॉसिबल। तो इस तरह से अग्रवाल पैकमूर ने ये नए नए सेगमेंट्स में काम किया है, एक नया और हमने वेस्टेज को ध्यान दिया, विच इज़ इनविजिबल। आप भी सोचेंगे कि ये क्या वेस्टेज है। जनरली मैनी फैक्ट्रीज इंडस्ट्री जो आप सामान को जो डिस्पैच करती है, वो किस पे निर्भर करती है? ट्रांसपोर्ट के ऊपर। और ट्रांसपोर्टर को ऑर्डर दे दिया, इन्वेंट दे दिया कि सुबह की भी मेरे को 10 गाड़ी चाहिए, 5 गाड़ी चाहिए, 6 गाड़ी चाहिए, इतने पार्सल भेजने हैं। और मैनी सिटीज़ दे डोंट हैव द इंट्री टाइम, नो एंट्री का टाइम होता है, कभी नो एंट्री के अंदर 8 o'clock, 8 PM, 10 PM, 9 PM गाड़ी आपके पास पहुँचती है, और फैक्ट्री या गोडाउन ऑफिस 6 बजे बंद हो जाते हैं। उनको अपनी मैन पावर के साथ में दे हैव टू वेट अप टू 9 PM, 10 PM, 10 बजे, 11 बजे इंतजार करता है, 5-6 लेबर रखेंगे, 2 सुपरवाइजर रखेंगे, और इट इज अ वेस्टेज। क्योंकि मगर गाड़ी आई, जब गाड़ी आएगी तो लोड करेंगे। हमने एक कंसेप्ट लॉन्च किया, हमने कहा कि व्हीकल अवेलेबल एट योर आई डिस्टेंस। आपको अभी किसी को फोन करने की जरूरत ही नहीं है, आँख खोलो गाड़ी खड़ी है, अरे आओ लोड कर दो। तो बोला ये कैसे पॉसिबल होगा? बोला ये पॉसिबल होगा क्योंकि व्हीकल्स 25 लाख की होती है। यदि मैं 20-20 व्हीकल एक फैक्ट्री के सामने खड़ी कर दूं, इट्स अ कॉस्ट, बहुत बड़ी मेरी कॉस्ट हो जाएगी। व्हाट वी हैव डन इट, हमने जो कंटेनर थे वो हर फैक्ट्री के अंदर 10-10 कंटेनर रख दिए, और कहा कि जब भी आपको ऑर्डर मिले किसी भी जगह का, किसी भी कंटेनर को बुलाओ, किसी के कंटेनर में लोड कर दो और ताला लगा दो, जस्ट ऐप के ऊपर कह दो कि लोड इट फॉर गुवाहाटी, लोड इट फॉर हैदराबाद, और आप अपने 6 बजे पैकअप होकर चले जाओ। प्रिपेयर योर पेपर, गिव टू द वॉचमैन एंड विल कम आफ्टर नो एंट्री टाइम। हम कैसे आएंगे? 4 कंटेनर्स की फैक्ट्री में उन्होंने भर दिए तो 4 एम्प्टी लाएंगे, वहाँ डंप करेंगे, 4 ले जाएंगे। 2 भर दिए तो 2 एम्प्टी लाएंगे, डंप करेंगे, उनका कोटा कितना? 10 का है। यू मस्ट हैव सीन, जिस तरह पानी की वो आपके पास कैन आते हैं घर में या आपकी ऑफिस के अंदर, वो क्या कर, हम एम्प्टी लाते हैं, वो केवल भरकर आता है, 6 भरकर लाएगा और 6 एम्प्टी लेके जाएगा, आपका कोटा पूरा। सेम सिस्टम में हमने किया कि तक व्हीकल्स यानी कंटेनर्स अवेलेबल एट योर आई डिस्टेंस। जो मगजमारी होती थी, पहुंचा नहीं पहुंचा, नो एंट्री में है, ड्राइवर ने पकड़ लिया, पुलिस ने पकड़ लिया, नो मोर पुलिस पकड़ेगी, आपके घर में अवेलेबल रहेगा और आपकी कॉस्ट उतनी ही, एंड नॉट उतनी। नाउ वी आर प्लानिंग मोर देन एज ऑन टूडे वी हैव मेड इट 2,500 कंटेनर्स, गोइंग टू बी 10,000 नेक्स्ट ईयर, एंड नेक्स्ट 5 ईयर्स वील हैव 1 लाख कंटेनर। जब हमारे पास 1 लाख कंटेनर हो जाएंगे तो हम इतनी आदत खराब कर देंगे कि आपकी इंश्योरेंस कंपनी कहेगी कि हमारा क्या होगा, क्योंकि नो जीरो ट्रांसशिपमेंट जीरो डैमेज, मोर ट्रांसशिपमेंट मोर डैमेज, लेस ट्रांसशिपमेंट लेस डैमेज, एंड वील मेक सच ए हैबिट कि जीरो ट्रांसशिपमेंट, और डैमेज ही नहीं होगा, आप होगी कि क्यों इंश्योरेंस करवाएं, तो इंश्योरेंस को जीरो हो जाएगा। दिस इज ऑल गोइंग टू बी हैपन। बाकी तो इनलैंड वाटरवेज और हमारी सागरमाला ये अपना काम कर रहे हैं, इंफ्रा अपना काम कर रहे हैं, एंड द डे विल टेक प्लेस 2025 में हम भी कहेंगे कि हिंदुस्तान की लॉजिस्टिक कॉस्ट अब 11, 12, 13 नहीं है, दैट इज इन सिंगल डिजिट। जय हिंद।
थैंक यू मिस्टर अग्रवाल। इट वॉज सर्टेनली आर मिस्टेक टू सेंड यू एज अ टेल एंडर बैट्समैन, यू सर्टेनली वर फिट एनफ टू गो एज एन ओपनर। Wonderful exposition from all the panelists, I must appreciate, and thank you to CILT. I just limited time for just 2 questions from the audience, any 2, kindly raise your hand.
Hi, I'm Anil. So as Mr. Agarwal discussed about optimizing the let's say any process related to warehousing or logistics. So personally, I can tell you about 2 use cases wherein the optimization resulted in, in case of warehousing, the data was collected, analyzed, and decongestion of trucks near the warehouse resulted in saving up to 50% of the transportation cost. And also a use case of cold chain, wherein the company saved almost 100,000 euros, a German company. So what are the, the private players' plans regarding this, because we had discussions about the expansion, how the plans are about expanding in let's say, quantities, but what about optimizing the current existing process?
Anybody would like to take this, or shall I attempt a reply? Actually, वो कह रहे हैं कि creation of, instead of creation of capacity, we should also look at optimizing the existing capacity. Today, there is a lot of empty running. If what are the measures we can take to optimize the existing capacity?
In fact, हमारी अपनी एक सोच का फर्क है. हम like you know अब अपनी अपनी सोच है. Like अब सर ने कहा था कि भी warehouse बहुत ज़्यादा होने चाहिए and आप लोग सही एग्री नहीं होंगे, बट मैं ये कहता हूँ कि हमारी वेयर हाउस के वगैरह भी काम कर सकता है. वी कैन मेक ए वर्चुअल वेयर हाउस. इट्स नॉट कंपलसरी कि आपके क्राउड वेयर हाउस हो. व्हाट वी हैव डन इट, लाइक इफ एक्सप्रेस पार्सल ये जो ट्रांसपोर्टेशन होता है, तो व्हाट द पीपल डू इट, कोई भी सामान उठाएंगे, एनी कार्गो कंपनी, सबसे पहले वो क्लाइंट के घर से पिक करेगी, एक अपने वेयर हाउस में रखेगी, छोटा वेयर हाउस होता है लाइक एजेंट वेयर हाउस, और एंड ऑफ द डे सभी एजेंट के से ही पिकअप होकर मदर वेयर हाउस में इकट्ठा हो जाएगा. मदर हाउस से फिर गुवाहाटी हैदराबाद मदर टू मदर जाएगा, फिर चाइल्ड में जाएगा, डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन होगा. दैट मीन देयर इज अ नीड फोर वेयर हाउस. यदि मैं मानता हूँ कि फोर वेयर हाउस एक एक जगह का कंजम्पशन 1,00,000 स्क्वायर फीट है, देन देयर इज नीड अ 4,00,000 स्क्वायर फीट. 4,00,000 स्क्वायर फीट वेयर हाउस का कंजम्पशन होगा एक छोटी सी कार्गो कंपनी को चलाने के लिए. अज्यूम करो कि 15 रुपीज पर स्क्वायर फीट का कॉस्ट है, इंफ्रा का कोर्स तो होता ही है. दैट मीन्स ही हैज टू स्पेंड 15 × 4,00,000 60,00,000 रुपीज स्क्वायर फीट. एंड दिस 60,00,000 रुपीज का जो कोस्ट है, ये कार्गो के फ्रेट के कंपोनेंट्स का एक हिस्सा है, लाइक डीजल यू आर पेइंग, टोल यू आर पेइंग, ड्राइवर की तनख्वाह यू आर पेइंग, टायर का खर्चा यू आर पेइंग. एंड सिमिलरली दिस इज 16% अगेन दिस इज इंफ्रा कोस्ट. मैं इसको 15 के बजाय 1% में कर सकता हूँ. दैट वी आर डूइंग इट. हम क्या करते हैं, हमारे पास जो कंटेनर है वो ओपन टू स्काई रहता है. इन प्लेस ऑफ 15 रुपीज वी पे ओनली 1.40 रुपीज पर स्क्वायर फीट. 1.40 रुपया हम उसका खर्चा लगता है, तो 15 − 2 रुपए 1.40, यानी कि 13 रुपए वी कैन पास टू द क्लाइंट. तो दैट इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड. हम उस एंगल से सोचेंगे तो हमारे को जरूरत ही नहीं है. आप ऐसा मॉडल बनाओ, सामान पिक किया कंटेनरों में, जैसे ICD में पड़े रहते हैं, ओपन में रखा, एंड ऑफ द डे लेके चले गए. तो हमारे को बहुत सोच को बदलना पड़ेगा कि हम इस, ये जरूरी है, क्यों जरूरी है, नहीं है, तो उसके अंदर ही सोचेंगे तो विल गेट द आइडिया. तो आप जो बोल रहे हो कि इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में ये चाहिए वो चाहिए, बट मेरी ख्याल के अंदर मैं समझता हूँ कि जो है उसके अंदर ही बेटर हम कर सकते हैं, बट वी हैव टू थिंक लिटिल बिट बियॉन्ड द बॉक्स. दैट्स माई कैलकुलेशन.
Thank you. I think you have been covering it well. So I have one point to make actually. See, in terms of the act, policies what have been there in already, and in terms of getting it implemented, and after the implementation, the results, the three part. So we have seen so many acts and rules. I'm talking about in terms of the special economic zone rules, which came in before that they were opened. So what I think now, this rule which has come, talking about integrated national policy which has came into it. I think we have come this document in 23rd of February 2000. 19. From that day till this day, I think the process is on. I think in between we had a couple of meetings taken by the Commerce Minister. My point is that, of course, I have gone through the rule. What we are covering is that all the aspects of the entire policy as a whole. But I find one thing what is there, ki if we get into dig down into the entire policy, the thing is that instead of diverting with the 60% of the entire movement on the road, 30% in the rail existing, or 9% which is talking of CBAs. Rather than that, from one structure to disturbing the other structure, why don't we structure the existing road itself, where the average cost or, you know, seamlessly operation can really add value to the entire operation, rather than concentrating, which is again difficult, because already we have established on the structure rail. So my question is that that provision are not given that particular policy. So can we do something about it in terms of getting the action, the result as a whole? Thank you.
Thank you. I was not here yesterday. I think there was a detailed discussion on this when Logistics Special Secretary was there. But your suggestion is very well taken. I think that should be it. and we should talk about the real integration. That is the purpose that logistics department is now working on. I hope something will come out in this. Thank you very much, Professor Ji.
Our gratitude to the panel for their time and insights. Please, ladies and gentlemen, join me in thanking the panel with a huge round of applause. I kindly invite our chair to felicitate the panel with a small token of our appreciation. Shri Kalyan Swaminathan. Shri Shashi Bhushan Shukla. Shri S.B. Mishra. Shri Tamal Roy. Shri Ramesh Agarwal. And Shri Naidu Adi Kesavulu Reddy. I'd also like to thank NDR Infrastructure Private Limited for powering this conference session. I'd like to invite Shri Sanjeev Garg, Vice Chairman CILT India, to kindly felicitate the Honorable Chair, Shri Anil Gupta, for a fabulous session concluded.